Grace, mercy, and peace to you. In the name of God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus. Amen. If you join me in prayer. Lord God, Holy Father, we thank you for your calling to us. We thank you that in particular the call goes out through all other callings to be people who follow. Who follow you in thought, in word, in action. Lord, we ask that you help us, you strengthen us in our commitment to follow. And to follow after you today. In your name, Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. So we are talking today about how we are called. We are called to follow God. We are called to follow God. The Christian church, this should be no secret for you, is called to follow God. We are called to follow God as he has been revealed to us in Jesus Christ. We are called to follow this one. And it's important for us, I think, in the 21st century, where it's really, really, really easy to follow the things that we like, or unfollow the things we like, to be people who are at least somewhat cognizant of what it is to actually follow, and how we get to do that. And so I want to talk about these readings. The reality of this call of God is often, and pretty clearly for Lutherans at least, it comes to us through means. God uses means to send forth this call, right? He uses voices, he uses sacraments, he uses water, he uses bread, he uses wine. He uses these means to bring forth people, to call them out to him. And in particular, you start to see this through the readings that we have in this day. You have Samuel, who's a little boy. He sits there, and he hears a voice, right? Do you hear voices too? Do you? Right? Samuel hears a voice, and the voice says, Samuel, right? If a voice is calling out to you, Samuel, and your name is not Samuel, then you can ignore it safely. Samuel hears a voice, but he gets confused by this voice. Right? Because his order, his process of thinking is that, you know, there's Eli, and Eli's over there, and, you know, he's there to attend to Eli, and he doesn't know that this voice is coming from God. You see in the text is the word of God is kind of minimalized at this point in time. There aren't visions that are happening. And so Samuel, he hears a voice, he gets confused. We're going to come back to that. Nathanael, here's a good one. He needs a word of vision before he goes off to follow, right? He needs for Jesus to tell him that he was sitting under a fig tree, for which he then turns around and says, you are the Messiah. You are the one that we've been waiting for, which is an extreme response to being told that you were sitting under a fig tree. But he hears it. And he's like, yeah, wait a minute, something, whatever Philip's been saying to him, yes, absolutely. But Nathanael, he needs something else to go off and to go follow Jesus. His first reaction, right, is, this one's from Nazareth, what good can come from Nazareth? Right? He rejects it. Paul says that the life of the Christian is to live in following Jesus. That's our life. That is our calling. And for 1 Corinthians 5 and 6, he talks a lot about the body and about how the body is the place where you go about living in this Jesus and following this Jesus. And that there's some serious issues that happen when people do not, in their bodies, in your physical body, follow Jesus. So we are called. And the reality of the call is that we're supposed to live in it. There may be some confusion. You may want something more than what you get in order to kind of be sure that you're going off and following the call of Jesus. But you, the reality is that you are called to follow him. Jesus, in fact, commands this, right? When he talks to Philip, when he talks to various other disciples, right? They're there. He says it specifically to them, but he's saying this for all of us as we read these words that he speaks. He says, follow me. follow me. It's an imperative, right? It's not like a request, it's not passive. You know, if you're not doing anything later, if you don't have any plans around 3:40, go ahead and follow me, right? If you're just not doing anything today, follow me. He said, follow me. Follow me. Right? Like that, I can't make that clearer than that. Follow me. I could probably shout it a little louder. But it's imperative. I want you to be a person who lives coming after me. Right? I will go on ahead. I will blaze that path through the snow. I will make holes for you to walk in. You come and step in those paths. You come and do the things that I have done. You come and be a part of who I am. Right? And so you go back to these other readings, and what does Eli tell Samuel to do? In order to follow this God, what is the first thing that Samuel has to do? He has to recognize that there's a voice that is calling him, and he has to listen. He has to actually listen to this voice that calls out to him. God calls out, and he calls out continually and repeatedly. He uses this scripture to call out to each and every one of us, and he says, I want you to follow me, and I need you, before you just decide to go do whatever you think that it is that you think I want you to actually hear what I am saying. And so he gives us the scripture, and he says, listen, follow me. And for us, speak, Lord. Your servant is listening. Right? I will listen by hearing this. That begins the act of following him. It begins the act of following him, not just, you know, at some point at confirmation or at, you know, really nice Bible study or whatever it is. It begins the act of following him every day. Like the act of following Jesus begins with our listening. Are listening to him in this day. What path is he leading us on? Where is God taking you in this life? Where is he taking us together as church? Where does he want to take us? And the answer to that, you go to Paul, or you go to Nathaniel too, but you go to Paul and Nathaniel, and they're both kind of in the same. His ultimate goal, his ultimate path, his purpose for you is to lead you to himself. He desires you to be with him. He desires you to be with him into eternity, and he desires you to be with him today. And he desires you that as you are with him, that you would do the things that he has actually done. Right? And so, like, one of the things that's difficult when you talk about following Jesus, like, well, so which things do you follow? Right? Because this is actually, I think, a lot of where 21st century and probably 20th century and probably 19th century and 18th century and 17th century Christianity, and really even probably before that. Well, which things do I follow? Right? There's a lot of stuff in here. I don't know if you've read the thing. There's a lot. Right? And so if you, you know, that seems nice for then. I should love my neighbor as myself. Yeah, you know, if you met my neighbor, right? They're not always that great. I should sacrifice and serve for those who are in need. I should give up of the things that I have. I should, well, you know, but I worked hard for that. I should keep my body pure and decent. I should keep my thoughts pure and decent. I shouldn't take from others. I should, in fact, give to them. I should not bear false witness. I should, instead, even for people I don't like, I should speak well of them. There's a lot. That's a lot to ask, Jesus. So how about I just pick? I'll pick the ones that are easy for me. I'll pick the ones that can be done. Right? It's way too hard not to talk bad about people. So I'll leave that one aside. But Jesus, I still follow you, just according to my own modified. There's an asterisk next to it. And he chose not to follow Jesus in this way, but he followed him the other ways. Jesus says, follow me. I want you to walk in my path. Because the end of the path, where it all leads, if you are following after, it all leads to me. I am there at the end of the path if you've been following in my footsteps. If you go off, if you're thinking of whatever, the last time you went hiking through the countryside here with some group of people and you wander off, they're not there at whatever location you wandered off to. Jesus says, if you follow after me, I will be there. If you don't, enjoy the trees, I guess. There will be obstacles to us as Christians. Those obstacles are real, they exist. Sometimes it is simply confusion. It's confusion about what voice is calling out. It's confusion about how much we should listen. It's confusion about, you know, here are the things that are right there in front of Samuel, and he hears them. But the Word of God, you know, it's kind of gone dry in that world. It's interesting. It's an interesting descriptor for the world. The Word of God goes dry. It goes away. There aren't a lot of visions. And Samuel, he says, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. The only way through the confusion is to listen for the voice of Jesus. There's going to be the desire for a sign, right? God, if you really favor me, let me win the lottery. Or God, if you really favor me, let the Vikings win a football game today, and then next week, and then the week, 2 weeks after. And then, right? If you really favor me, God, give me a sign! If you really favor me, if this is really the path that I should be on, give me a sign. And Jesus, for Nathanael, he does. He gives him some kind of sign. Even though Nathanael, skeptical Nathanael, he's like, man. But he's like, yeah, I saw you under a fig tree. Oh, okay. The greatest opposition, the greatest difficulty to actually following Jesus, the greatest place of us having obstacles in this life is going to be ourselves. Jesus can be really important in theory. He can be really important to the mind. He can be really important for whatever thoughts that we have, but when it gets down to living it, this is what the Corinthian church had to figure out, when it gets down to living it, well, you know, there's things, and my body has desires, and I have urges, and I, you know, if my stomach rumbles, I'm going to go feed it, Jesus. You know what I'm saying? Except they weren't talking about their stomachs. Greatest obstacles, ourselves. But Jesus still says, right? His whole point to this, and the whole point to all of this, follow me. Follow me. I want you to follow me. I want you to do it today. I want you to do it here this morning in our worship. I want you to do it when you leave our worship. I want you to be out there. I want you to be engaged with this. I want you to think. I mean, as you think about the things that you do and the ways that you make choices and the who you are and the whose you are, to think, I will act in this because I am in Jesus. And Jesus has shown me this path forward. Jesus has shown me this way. I will lay down my life. The interesting thing, the last thing, Jesus tells Nathanael the thing that Stephen actually says in Acts later on. He tells Nathanael that Nathanael will see heaven open, right? Because Nathanael will see at the end of the path Jesus. As Nathanael walks in, without, go read the book of Acts to get more on Stephen, but Stephen, at the end of his path, the thing that he sees is Jesus, right? That's why he wants you to follow after him. more than anything else, he wants you to see him at the end of the path. He wants us there. He wants us there with him. He wants us to see this heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. He wants this for us all. And he wants this for this world. And so he says to you, and he says to me, and he says it here at the beginning of this year when we fortunately who don't live in Hawaii, we don't have to deal with nuclear alerts yet. He says, I want you to follow me wherever this leads you here in this world, because you don't know. You don't know where this goes. But I want you to know that I'm the one who's there, wherever it may be. In the name of Jesus, amen. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for you. We thank you that you are the path for us. You are the way. You call that out again and again. You've asked us, Lord, to follow you, to be people who live in you. And Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to be so. We ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Our worship continues with the gathering of our offering.